Match number three. Any predictions?
Well, I know what Ifra's on. He's playing Doomsday.
Doomsday. That Doomsday deck is great. I didn't even notice when we went back and did you see the archetype slide we put up during the pregame show? Doomsday had the best record. Doomsday was just great.
I mean, this is spoiler for, you know, the next season of BSL, but I think Doomsday might be the best deck. I think it's fast enough that it outraces the uninteractive decks, and it's resilient enough that I think it's good against the control decks.
All right, so there is the Doomsday for Eric Froelich. Chris is on Delver. Now, how's this matchup specifically?
This one's pretty close. I mean, I think the only thing that makes Doomsday not insane, I mean, even if I say it's the best deck, I think obviously it's like very beatable. Like, its matchups against workshops can be tough. You have to sideboard a lot. And Delver is just a close race because they have disruption plus a decent clock. So I don't think you mind playing against Delver, but it's not like you're playing against one of the matchups that you actually want to play against. Like, you want to play against like the slower blue decks. Like, Monastery Mentor is a much better matchup, I think, than Delver.
Sure.
So one of the interesting things about Ifros is you see the Dark Ritual there. The deck is actually playing
going to turn one Dark Ritual Doomsday, isn't he?
Yeah, with Force Mental Misstep backup, of course. The deck's actually playing three Dark Rituals, and part of the reason is it makes it Doomsday kills like this a lot more likely, and you get to play Necropotence, and I really like both those changes.
I read three Dark Rituals in my Doomsday deck in the quarterfinals. I'm a fan.
Like, I understand the reasoning behind playing one, because it is definitely like a combo card, but honestly, like, I think the backlash against Misstep's overblown. Like, Dark Ritual is just too good in the Doomsday deck, I think, to not play more of them.
Yeah, it's certainly the existence of Mental Misstep is why people have stopped playing Dark Rituals. But okay, fine. I think all that really means is you can't rely on Dark Ritual. It doesn't mean you have to cut them all. And it makes a lot of sense to me. Go up, you know, two, three, maybe even four Dark Rituals. You say he's on three?
Yeah, three and a Necropotence is like the fifth triple block spell that wins you games. I don't know if you've ever played Necro before, but it's a pretty fun card. And another reason is that you get to fit these cards in against Chris specifically is that Ifro's playing less Flusterstorms because he didn't put Chris on very many decks that were impacted by Flusterstorms.
Hey, did Eric was supposed to fetch on the first turn?
Oh
right?
Yeah, he actually that actually might lose him this game.
He can't gush now
because Chris has Strip Mine. So,
oh, holy shit. Yeah, no, he's on zero mana, right?
Yeah.
If Chris strips, which he should after the Doomsday.
He should. I think Chris's best chance of winning the game is to go Strip Mine and then have Misdirection up, which obviously is nice, but that is up no matter what. You get to... Chris's other option is to play have Pyroblast up, but I would much rather Strip Mine. I think you're more likely to Miza win. But yes, Strip Mining... Ifro not playing the fetch is gonna be tough because now he has to have a Doomsday pile that either leaves a land in, which he might be able to do because he doesn't need all the cards, but it's still gonna mess things up, especially since fetching rearranges the order. Yeah, this could be actually a pretty big misstep for Ifro.
Do you think he was planning? I mean, was he planning to fetch out of the Doomsday pile, or did he just like play the wrong land on turn one?
I assume he played the wrong land on turn one.
Does seem the most likely to me as well.
Just because there's no advantage to doing that, it just requires you to leave another card in the Doomsday pile. You'd much rather leave a random like Gitaxian Probe or something.
I was going to say, it gives you the ability to thin the deck by a card.
Yeah, but the deck shouldn't have... At the worst, you can, again, put a probe in there, which cycles. Like, there's no advantage to doing that. So this actually... And the thing is, it actually might end up costing Ifro because... He's going to have to – I mean, even if he adds a land to the pile, it still could mess up his ordering and make it a lot tougher for him to win the game.
It also meant that, like, by not fetching – I mean, if he doesn't put a land in the pile, he can't use Gush.
It's true. I don't know how much Gush is part of it, but he might want to build a pile that doesn't, you know, take Gush into account.
Yeah,
Chris is looking to draw. Well, actually, you know, Chris looks like he might have drawn the perfect card anyway. Ifro is unlikely to win this game through Force and Misdirection just because Ancestral Recall is such a big part of all the piles that Misdirection is going to stop it. I wonder if Chris is going to leave up Pyroblast now.
Wow. He's looking at that Strip Mine. Chris doesn't know the Strip Mine is insane. Chris has no way to know that the Strip Mine is insane. Although Chris kind of can know that Strip Mine is good. Like, Eric's made a bunch of Doomsday calculations. Strip Mine is certainly going to throw them off.
Yeah, it's.
But I mean, Pyroblast is also good. It's a legit fork in the road whether Chris should play Volcanic to have up Pyro or play Strip Mine.
I would much rather play Strip Mine. I think it's more likely that Ifro. First of all, it's more Ifro could have Misstep versus land, and those are both, potentials. The second is that even if Ifro has Misstep, taking rid of or extra land, taking his land out means that we'll disrupt his plans because he just can't play multiple lands a turn. Like if Ifro has two lands in his hand right now, so
Well,
now
there was the Ancestral.
we get to see if Ifro left. Even if Ifro left a land in his in even if he didn't leave a land in his deck, he's still gonna pass the turn here to at least see what Chris is playing. Because right now Chris could be on almost any well, almost anything.
He could be on a second copy of Shops for all
Yeah.
we know, right?
So it
He
looks
could
like
still.
Ifro did leave a land in. And as it turns out, Ifro's gonna lose regardless of the fetch land thing because Chris drew the Force of Will. Because now Chris gets to go misdirection, Ifro forces, Chris forces, and then Ifro's effectively dead.
I mean, he can use his draw phase to keep
Yeah.
drawing. He's not actually dead.
He can wait a bunch, but the extra Chris drawing an extra three cards. I guess Ifro can use his last misstep. And Chris still having Pyroblast in hand is gonna make it tough.
Yeah, the Pyroblast is going to wind up killing a maniac, is probably what's going to happen.
So Ifro's last three cards are going to be Lotus, Lab Maniac, and Gitaxian Probe is my assumption.
Makes sense.
So the ordering doesn't matter, and Ifro had an extra card. So actually, it looks like the not playing the land wasn't a big deal, but Chris drawing the Force of Will was a big deal.
Yeah, if Chris hadn't drawn Force of Will right
It,
there,
then
then
Ifro would
they're
have won.
through a strip mine.
Through a strip mine, yes.
And but what he couldn't win through was strip mine and two Force of Wills.
Well, the strip mine didn't even matter because Ifro doesn't need the extra land. So Ifro now gonna mental misstep his own ancestral.
Yep, he
Or
goes again
not.
too.
He might not because it stops like something like Pyroblast or other missteps. You just have to hope Chris doesn't draw anything.
Wow. That was his line. Hope Chris doesn't draw anything. Just the misstep, though, means now
Yeah.
we've got Eric's library at Black Lotus, Lab Maniac, and a card draw thing, probably a probe.
I believe that is accurate, and I think that, and that means that Ifro can't win the game because just Chris just gets to go Pyroblast, Ifro missteps, Chris missteps, and then the Lab Maniac doesn't resolve.
Now, if Eric did not have to put a land in his library because he fetched on the first turn, could he have put in like a Flusterstorm or something?
Yeah, he could have. I mean, it couldn't actually end up costing him if, given the way this game is played out, because it's going to take a few extra turns. And had he drawn the last card and had it be a Flusterstorm, that would have been enough. Chris is getting to see a bunch of cards. I mean, Chris looks like he's on pretty classic Blue Red Delver Pyromancer here.
Yep.
But no one's arguing that not playing that playing the lands of that order was good. It was definitely not good. The question is whether that turned this game from a win into a loss. It may have. It's not zero. It's not looking great for Ifro, even if he has access to one extra card, though.
Yeah, but your theory is Eric was losing anyway, given Chris's draw.
I think so. It's not guaranteed, because if, as you said, if Ifro's last card was a Flusterstorm, let's say he waits one more turn, and his last card's a Flusterstorm, what would that have done? Though I guess he would have had to draw two extra cards because he'd have an extra card in his deck. He'd have to wait two extra turns, and Chris does get to cast Dig Through Time end of turn here. So I find it unlikely to believe that Ifro would have won, though
Sure.
obviously it was quite close regardless.
There's certainly hands Chris could have had where that would have been the difference.
And Chris, of course, not playing Pyromancer because you don't need to. Ifro's going to deck in a turn or two turns,
Right.
so.
Yeah, no reason to tap mana for that guy and make creatures. Eric has one card in his library.
And Chris now finds a Force of Will, which, well and thoroughly locks up the game here.
And an Ancestral. You can just finish him off now.
Well, Ancestral is good because Chris can pitch to Force of Will. So you can just Ancestral Ifro like on his upkeep or something. Just make him tap mana if he has it. You can also just pass and leave all your mana up, which seems pretty good too, because I mean, it doesn't matter too much. Like, we can see all the hands, and Chris is going to win no matter what. But I kind of don't mind just passing with Ancestral up and waiting for till Ifro taps his mana for Lab Maniac.
I think I would do it this way. Just upkeep Ancestral him. You know he's got, you know he can't fight it.
Yeah, it's unlikely.
All right. Well, Chris is not going to get shut out.
No, he's not.
Now the question is, can he win a match?
Can yeah, he win
your match four thing to the theory?
Yeah, I think it's quite reasonable. The interesting thing is, let's say Chris does win this match. What decks do you think the other two people bring?
Right, this is the fun of this format. We haven't actually
seen a single time. I would lead with, I think the Workshops deck from Ifro seems like the strongest because it looks like it's good against Merfolk and I think advantaged in the mirror. Generally, Workshop decks are decent against Delver. Even if Chris knows that, even if it's like Ifro's like, all right, I've locked in Workshops, what are you going to do? Mm-hmm. I mean, maybe it depends on Chris's sideboard. I guess you can play Delver because it didn't look like the Merfolk deck had enough of a sideboard to really feel like you're ahead against a deck with Sword and Trike.
Yeah, it had a couple of cards, but given that he saw the sword and and I don't think he saw.
I guess he didn't see Trike, but he saw like Wormcoil Engine. Like that card alone, kind of trades for True Name. You can make it so Wormcoil can't attack, but then you're not attacking either.
Right. Yeah, no, I think he saw enough to know that the Merfolk is not good against that version of Shops. Chris also knows the Vintage format well enough that he may have seen the Ravager and suspected the Triskelion. If that's a thing that's floating around somewhere out there.
It is. I mean, I played against that deck like many years ago, which is why I actually looked for the way I found the deck is I typed in Archon Ravager on the on the search bar for MTG Top 8, like looking at Vintage decks. So, that was the deck I had in mind. So yeah, it is not like a completely unknown quantity. So these are some good hands. Ifro being on the play means he's got a good shot of resolving Ancestral since he's got Ancestral plus Misstep plus Force.
Yes, that should be good enough.
Yeah, usually is before Chris has a chance. So I expect a stop on upkeep here before Chris has a chance to Flusterstorm. Do you like forcing Ancestral? I go back and forth. I mean, it's obviously very contextual. It's not like there's a hard and fast rule, but I lean towards forcing it most of the time.
You're on yes, force it?
Yeah, I feel like most of the time it's worth trading. Like there aren't that many individual cards that are better than Ancestral to counter with Force, especially in a blue versus blue matchup. The question is what to pitch here. I think it's between Preordain and I honestly think Delver might be a better pitch than Flusterstorm. Well, the Treasure Cruise actually doesn't look like it's that close. You probably can't pitch Preordain and keep Treasure Cruise. That's probably insanity. Yeah, Treasure Cruise is actually at its worst against the it is at its worst against like the Doomsday decks because it's not really an attrition war as much as you're trying to stop them from going off. They don't usually rally and do it too many more times.
All right, Eric is going to force back and Ancestral resolves. No land though.
Yeah, Ifro's a few bayous short of casting things, but Ifro does get to misstep whatever Chris plays here if Chris taps mana for something, which I think he will. I mean, leaving up Flusterstorm here seems like it's unnecessarily passive. You do want to start getting something on the board. I would probably misstep this, especially since Xanad Swarm shuts off a lot of Chris's counter magic. You don't need to misstep that much after this.
Right.
So, and then Chris did bring in Tormod's Crypt, which he's about to play here, which clearly an anti-dredge card. If you have extra lightning bolts, I guess you can play Crypt, but you do know that they have Xanatorms often, so. I don't know. I don't love Tormod's Crypt in general. It shuts off Yawgmoth's Will. It's basically like a one for one.
It's a preemptive counter for Yawgmoth's Will.
It's a one for one, except you drew the Crypt, and they just don't tutor for the Will, because they have a lot more copies of Will in their deck because of tutors. So it's I think it's generally card disadvantage, but.
You'd rather have a lightning bolt against potential Xanatorms?
It's pretty common for the deck to board in Xanad Swarms.
Agreed.
Here we go.
And indeed, here we go. So Eric was able to, ponder his way into land?
Yeah, he preordained into a land, and he kept, a land to get green to cast Xanad Swarm next turn. He's going to attack a Xanad Swarm and then preordain to try to hit a black land, after which he can Demonic Tutor. He could potentially Demonic Tutor for something like Gush. He could also just draw the land right away.
Sometimes that happens too.
And notably, Chris didn't play a second land. Chris preordained, I sent two to the bottom, drew Time Walk.
Yep.
So Ifro is heavily favored to go to game three here. He's got a lot of mana, he's got a lot of time, and Xanasaur means that Chris can't basically do anything to stop him. Chris has no clock in play, and none of his spells do anything. Which is not a good place to be. Like, it's to the point where Ifrit doesn't even need to cast Thoughtseize. There's just nothing to Thoughtseize into. Like, you just know Chris's cards don't do anything. Getting Gush makes a lot of sense here. It's a draw two, but it also adds two mana, which lets you play Preordain. And if you have a mana left over, you will cast Thoughtseize. You might as well take Chris's card draw spell.
Yeah, Gush is indeed the selection. Man, Fast Bond makes that card so ridiculous.
Yeah, and it's another reason that I like the Doomsday deck. Sometimes it just has all these different parallel combos. It's got Doomsday plus three black mana, Fast Bond plus Gush, Yawgmoth's Will plus Rituals. Like, it's just all these different things going on, and you assemble them so well.
Yeah, certainly had the best regular season performance. I mean, if Eric can rattle off a couple games here, it may win him a Vintage Super League championship. Now, where are you at on the Delver deck? I know that coming into the year, it felt like Delver was the best deck in Vintage. It was certainly the deck that was getting the most play. You know, four people ran it in the first trimester. Where is Delver these days?
I think Delver is solidly in tier one, along with, I guess if I had to make a sampling of what I consider the high tier decks, it would be Workshop's decks, some build of that, some build of Delver, Doomsday, I think are all the decks that I think are the best.
Okay.
And I think Delver, you can build it to beat different decks. Like, you can play more Lightning Bolts to beat creature-based decks. You can play more sideboard cards against Workshops. You can play more counter magic against disrupt or against combo decks. So overall, I think Delver is easily tier one. It's just quite good. It's just a fast clock disruption. Can still do some like semi-broken stuff. Its biggest disadvantage is it doesn't do like actual broken stuff. But mm-hmm. So we had some trading cards here where Ifrit managed to trade away all of Chris's cantrips, so now Chris isn't doing anything. But Ifro's not doing anything either. Ifro has some counters and a Doomsday, so once he finds to triple black, I imagine he will be able to win this game.
Yeah, no card drawing to bootstrap his way into the Doomsday pile, but he's not afraid to use his draw step to get there when he's got Flusterstorm and Force of Will.
Ifro is at 8 life. That's not a lot of life, and his force is going to get forced back here, so Doomsday making him pay half his life means that he might actually leave Xanthworm back so he can chump with it. Since he knows Chris's last cards, that he was able to see that. So Ifrit does need to draw a triple black or a card draw spell before too long, which he did.
He's calling Tarn. So he goes to 6, then he goes to 3. Yeah.
Doesn't do it because then he gets time walked out.
Time walk makes an elemental. Eric loses this on life. Hilarious.
So I think what Ifrit needs to do here is just pass the turn. He could play Tarn or not. And then gets hit for 6 total or 5. 2 plus 3. So 5 total, going down to 2, and then hope to draw a card draw spell. You can still cast Doomsday. I guess if you crack Scalding Tarn, I guess you can't cast Doomsday.
Yeah, no, you can't.
So I guess you have to chump with Xanthworm the second time to stay at like 3 life, and then Doomsday down to 1. But yep. You can't actually cast Doomsday here. And I think Eric knows that.
Well, I think if you chump block with Xanad Swarm, I think you can. The trick is not to cast Doomsday now, but to say go.
Sorry, yeah. You can cast Doomsday, but you can't do it if you impasse the turn. You have to do it after you take the hit. Though drawing Gush means that Ifrit could easily not survive here.
Also true. Yeah, Eric is basically playing to top deck a card draw spell of some kind so that he can Doomsday and then bootstrap into the pile. But Chris wants to kill him before we get to that.
Yeah, Eric drew the Scalding Tarn one turn too late here. I mean, he didn't have that many turns off. I think he only had like 2 turns where he passed and did nothing, but that obviously is a lot in Vintage. So
Gush with 2 floating.
Basically, Chris needs to draw like a castle spell. I think. Can you cast Pyroblast here? Is that good?
Yes. I mean, it is legal to target.
Well, no, I know you can. The question is it strong to cast it here? You get to attack you for down to 5. That forces a Xanted Swarm chump block, but it doesn't do a whole lot else. Is that right?
Yeah, it doesn't. It's not the difference. If you cast Pyroblast and misstep it,
you turn off Scalding Tarn. You know, it might actually not be bad for Chris to do that, though.
You're going to throw away Pyroblast and misstep just to turn off Scalding Tarn?
Yeah, that's probably not great.
Although now he kind of wants to tap his mana for dig through time, so.
So the question is, if you're Ifrit, I think you chump block here to keep things live.
3.
But that does mean that Chris's Pyroblast plus Mental Misstep are almost assuredly enough to lock things up, just
Yeah, I don't
because
know
there's
what the
not very many ways to draw cards that aren't blue.
Does he have a top in his deck?
I don't know if he has Sensei's Divining Top. Let's take a look. It does not look like it, no.
And then he has to also build a pile that doesn't have blue cards in it. So I don't think
or one, but he's even can't even do one casting cost cards because of the Mental Misstep. So Ifrit, of course, has to cast Doomsday and go for it, but which is unfortunate because that means Ifrit has to cast Doomsday and make a pile. Yeah.
Yeah, the Doomsday part resolves. Oh, he's going to dig through time. I guess he's still got the misstep up.
Yeah, the misstep helps, but this dig through time is a little risky. Like, what if Ifrit's hand is like a gush and you dig and you don't hit Force of Will? Seems like Pyroblast gives you so many more outs.
I agree.
Wow. Yeah, had Ifrit drawn Gush, he would have actually had a chance if Chris didn't hit Force of Will off of Dig Through Time, which is not super likely. Chris also has the misstep, so even if there's not that many kills that Ifrit can assemble, especially with Tormod Script in play, that don't lose to Mental Misstep, so it's going to be tough.
Oh, right. The Tormod Script is in play. Can't, isn't the Ancestral in the graveyard?
Yeah,
Tormod Script is going to wipe away Ifrit's graveyard before the Doomsday can get at any of those cards.
Well, with Fastbond, and I guess Fastbond doesn't matter too much, but with five lands in play, you can also just set up a double Gush pile pretty easily. So,
like, yeah,
you can.
It is the one other thing that Tormod Script can hypothetically do is you might be able to exile a card they actually need as part of their Doomsday pile, but it looks like Chris found the Force of Will with the Dig Through Time, so Doomsday's not going to resolve anyway.
Yeah, finding the Force of Will does mean that Doomsday is likely not going to resolve. It seems kind of risky. Though I guess you can just counter Ifrit's last card also.
Sure. I Force of Will Doomsday here.
What if Ifrit's last card is a Gush? If you force Doomsday and Ifrit gushes into Flusterstorm in response, that could be kind of annoying. I mean, you still have the Mental Misstep, but... Though, for everyone's sake, Ifrit is going to just end this game here. Because once Chris forces his Doomsday.
Guess what?
Somehow.
We get a fourth match!
Yeah.
We did it! Chris did it.
Yeah, Well, we didn't do it. We definitely did not do it.
No,
Chris did it. Chris was the one who was taking us to a game match four here. My prediction is that Ifrit leads with workshops, and maybe Chris, depending on sideboards, either has Delver or his own workshop deck.
Yeah.
I don't think you play Merfolk there, but it's possible you do.
All right, Chris's Delver deck sideboards 4 Ingot Chewers, 2 Ancient Grudge. That's a pretty good sideboard, and a Mountain.
Yeah, that's a solid... You know, like slightly high. It's actually not that much higher than average. That's about what I would expect if you want to have a plausible shot of beating workshops.
And he's 3 Delvers in the main, which is usually it's the one matchup where that card's good. He's also got 2 Dakfaden main in that Delver list.
Yeah.
2 Lightning Bolts. So you've got Ifro on shops, and you think Chris should have Ifro on shops and therefore should play his Delver list.
That's my initial prediction. I could see Ifrit just playing Delver if he thinks he's advantaged in the Delver mirror, going down that chain of logic. Of course, the interesting part about the best of five is that, you know, you have a player on level one and you have another player trying to be on level two, but you don't want to be on level three when they're on level one. You want to be on level three when they're on level two. You also want to be one above them, because otherwise you end up playing a Merfolk deck against a Workshop deck. If you think Merfolk's favored against Delver and you think Delver's favored against Workshops and you think they're going to play Workshops, like, at some point it becomes absurdity, but... I think that there are a lot of different ways you could go here. Level one, I think, is workshops against Delver. I think if one player goes to level two, you could end up Delver versus Delver. And if Chris goes a level behind that, you can end up Chris on Merfolk versus Ifrit on Delver. I mean, it's also possible that one of them just plays Doomsday or Workshops anyway, but those are my initial predictions without knowing exactly what the sideboard is in all the particular games. So...
In the chat, Eric says, now I know how everyone else has felt.
Yeah. That is true.
Chris also offered the anecdote. His son Maddox came by. Chris said he was losing, and Maddox said, you have 20, and he has 19.
Yeah, that is accurate. So now they're, looks like the game is up. So Chris has decided, Ifro still has to decide what to join the game with.
Interesting.
Yeah, so I really like this playoff series. I mean, I'm curious what feedback other people have on it. I mean, obviously the viewers, you guys get to say what you like, what you don't like. I like this a lot better than last year's. I mean, last year was season one and we're trying new things. So it looks like Ifro went to level, what I think is level two, and Chris went to level one. And it looks like we're going to have a Delver mirror here to potentially decide things.
Interesting. So what are the key cards in the Delver mirror?
Getting a Pyromancer out and getting a couple tokens is usually pretty hard to come back from because that, neither deck has a ton of ways to sweep a large board. Like Pyromancer 3 tokens is really hard to beat. But card advantage is also really important. So some of the games end up with both players with no threats in play, then one player resolving Dig or Cruise or having a DAC in play. It's also possible to just play a Delver and a Pyromancer and just run over your opponent. So it's a kind of weird, control-ish matchup that does certainly rely on card advantage, but both players also have creatures and are better at playing threats than they are at removing them. So it's a strange matchup. But they both have decent hands for it. I mean, they're both going to get to play some cards. Chris's hand is gonna change a lot more than Ifro's. Chris gets to probe Ifro and then make his decisions, with Preordained based on that. Ifro's hand is not drawing a lot of cards. It's playing a turn one Delver. It has Misdirection and Spell Pierce, and it has a couple Dak Phaetons, but it's not got a bunch of cantrips. Another thing that's interesting about this matchup is there's so much card flow that both players do get to see a lot of cards. So you do actually get rewarded for using your cards well because you see so many of them and you get to make so many decisions on which cards you want that you can choose which. I mean, that's one of the strengths of Delver is that it gets to choose whether it wants to play control or aggro based on what it sees from its opponent. So Chris sees a Black Lotus and a Strip Mine there. I don't love Strip Mine in general. And Ifro's on two lands, but the games tend to go long enough that attacking their mana is not super valuable. I could see taking Lotus so you can Lotus out Dak, though that's also not particularly exciting. Chris actually just binned both cards. I would have kept the Lotus just because Lotus Dak is not bad, especially if your opponent can't counter it. And if you know that Ifro is going to play turn one Delver, for example, and if you draw one of your Delve cards, Lotusing out a Dig Through Time or Pyromancer even better is pretty awesome.
Bottom does draw him toward those cards, though. I don't know.
It's true, but Chris has a lot of card draw, so I think adding mana to that is good. I don't think it's huge, though. I don't think it's guaranteed that you should be keeping Lotus.
It's not like he could Lotus out the deck that turn, though, right? Because he can't make the blue and the red.
Not on turn one, no, but he could on turn two, because you can predict that Ifro's going to play a turn on Delver, because it's just such a natural play. See, here, had Chris kept Lotus, he would not have seen Force of Will. He would have seen Volcanic Gush Pyromancer. But having, Lotusing out Pyromancer and then playing a Preordain is a pretty good start to things, especially with Pyroblast to make sure it happens, though most of Ifro's hand. So I don't know. That's one of the reasons I like Lotus is it lets you kind of get ahead early here. Though this is still pretty good. I mean, both players are going to have a decent amount to work with. Chris is, I think, advantaged because he's got a lot more card flow. He was on the play and Ifro's got double DAC. Plus, Chris knows about Misdirection and Spell Pierce. Cards are not great when your opponent knows about them.
He's going to Pyroblast the Delver right now. Eric could hypothetically misdirect this with his backup DAC.
He could. I don't love doing that. I find that Delver doesn't decide the games all that often. I think Pyromancer and DAC decide the games a lot more frequently.
I mean, I think Chris knows this can be misdirected and doesn't care.
Yeah. Yeah, you can force back if you want. I don't think I would.
I don't think Chris is going to force back.
Because Chris's Pyromancer is just going to win the race much easier. No, Ifro did flip the Delver.
Mm-hmm.
And Preordain's a good one to reveal.
Oh, yeah.
So he's going to crack his fetch first. It's just normal operating procedure when you're going to Preordain. If you want to see multiple cards and leave two on top and draw one, you don't want to leave fetch on top, and you want to crack your fetches sooner rather than later. Brainstorm's really the only card that rewards you for keeping fetches. So Ifro has Spell Pierce up. What Ifro's looking for is... Actually, Delver is pretty good. The second Delver I may actually force if I'm Chris. two Delvers can race a Pyromancer, especially since one's already face up here. At this point, Ifrit is kind of all in on these Delvers, and you're ahead on cards. You don't want to. You get no bonus points for, you know, having a Force of Will in your hand at the end of the game. And Dak is, I think, not going to be super relevant for Chris either here.
He agrees with you. Takes 3 down to 12.
This game is going to hinge a lot on who can find the first removal spell.
Yeah. Like, if Pyromancer into Gush into Preordain.
Yeah, but imagine if Chris Pyromancer gushes and then finds a Pyroblast. He's a huge favorite to win. Whereas if he goes, you know, Gush Preordain, and then Ifrit draws a Lightning Bolt and has Lightning Bolt with Spell Pierce back, then now Ifrit is in really good shape. Yeah, Force of Will is not horrendous. Ifrit's still on track to win. Flipping Delver right away was huge, but so Chris may end up being able to play enough spells that he's going to win. In which case, Force of Will is good. If you're losing the race, Force of Will is less good because then Ifrit doesn't have to play anything to win the game.
Wow, Ancestral and Dig Through Time.
What do you? I like the Ancestral for sure. I might actually not take the Dig. Yeah, it's a lot of cards, but you're going to tap. You're just going to want to play Ancestral next turn probably, and you have Gush already. I don't know. I kind of like don't want the Dig Through Time here. You could actually cast Dig instead of Ancestral, I suppose. Maybe Dig is better just because you just cast Ancestral. I don't know. I have a hard time putting Ancestral on the bottom.
Did we see what he did there? Was that top bottom or top top?
I don't know if he kept the Dig Through Time. I mean, clearly he kept Ancestral. Looks like he kept just one.
Okay, so the Dig did go to the bottom. Yeah, finding that second blue mana is going to be tricky.
So because Ifrit drew Dig...
Oh, there's the Pyroblast.
Oh, wow, that's big. Yeah, because Ifrit drew Dig, he also gets to keep mana up now because he can go Spell Pierce as a 6 card and then cast Dig. But this is looking pretty good for Chris here. I think the Pyroblast really makes it hard for him to lose this game. I mean, clearly, if Dig resolves, things can happen, but... If you start by Pyroblasting, you know you're going to get Spell Pierced. Then you Ancestral in response. Ifrit can't cast Dig in response, and you have Force of Will. It's a pretty big game. You're also getting Pyromancer tokens this whole time, which means that Chris is going to, looks like, win the race here. Barring Ifrit drawing a Time Walker or a Lightning Bolt.
Yeah, so there's the Spell Pierce on the Pyroblast, as you predicted. Chris knew it was coming as well. He saved his Ancestral as the follow-up.
Ifrit can't Dig because the Spell Pierce is on the stack, not in the graveyard. So Ancestral is going to resolve.
Oh, wow. Yeah, he's one mana short of the Dig Through Time.
And then Chris has it all. He has Force, Misdirection, Misstep now. So I think Chris has this game pretty locked up.
Yeah, Misstep on the Spell Pierce, making another elemental token. Now his Pyroblast is going to resolve. I guess Eric can still Dig as a response to the Pyroblast and probably should, right?
Yeah.
Go fishing for a mental misstep, except, of course, we know Chris has Force of Will.
Yeah, and Force of Will pitching Delver seems like the only play that really makes sense here. You don't need the Delver. You're going to win the race already with Pyromancer. It doesn't change anything. And
you don't need the DAC either.
Yeah, the DAC, yeah, either one is actually fine here. Basically, as long as you keep Gush and Misdirection, you know, you're in good shape.
Right, so no Dig Through Time for Eric, and Pyroblast kills the Delver, and now, yeah, kablam. Chris suddenly has 8 power, or 9 power worth of creatures. 8 power. And Eric is just digging desperately with the Dak Faden.
I guess Eric could potentially string together like some sequence of lightning bolts, but with a Misdirection in hand, it's going to be tough. And the Gush, too. I mean, Chris is going to see some new cards and already has everything he needs. Can Chris afford to... He can deal 8?
Can he kill Dak? Is that your question?
Yeah, I think he can. I think he can... Because he can kill Dak and then send 40 for down to 10. And the next turn, as long as he's played a spell, he can deal lethal, assuming he plays the Delver. He doesn't even need to flip the Delver, so... You might as well kill Dak. There's no reason to let Ifrit see new cards. Yeah, you can just play Pyromancer and Delver. Actually, you could just play Pyromancer and not play Delver. That might even be better, because that way you can pitch Delver to Misdirection and have Mental Misstep up. Not that Ifrit is getting out of this, but you might as well make it even
No,
that
two
much less
lightning bolts is
likely.
probably the easiest way for Eric to get out of this.
Yeah, but either way, you still have Mental Misstep, so it's going to be tough for Chris to lose this. Chris is actually going to keep Mental Misstep hard cast up and then not play the Pyromancer. I guess if you don't play anything, you do have to not attack the deck to not give Ifrit extra time, but even if you attack the deck, Ifrit's not going to be able to do anything with that extra draw step anyway, most likely, unless he's got like something crazy up.
Well, no, he killed the deck and put him at 11. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Yeah, I think Eric gets a turn out of that.
He drew a lightning bolt. So now Ifrit can actually lightning bolt Chris to enable Dig. Dig is going to resolve. Lightning bolt, I assume, is not. You
Just
know?
pay for misstep here? Oh, you know what? Misdirection is actually lethal. Huh.
Yeah.
Hilariously. Misdirecting the lightning bolt back to Eric would be good enough. Oh, but Eric has seen enough.
Yeah, it looks like.
Eric has seen enough. Mental misstep. He's done.
So.
Can Chris come all the way back?
It's possible. I mean,
He
clearly
was
he's.
down two matches, and then was he was down a game as well, right?
He was down two matches. No, he never was down a game
He never
against
lost a game to
Doomsday. Yeah,
Doomsday?
he 2-0'd Doomsday. So.
Okay. Oh, right. That was just Eric had the turn one Doomsday draw that it felt
Right.
like Chris was going to lose the first game. And in fact, Chris top decked the Force of Will to not lose the first game.
Right. And I think it ends up that if they go to a match five, then it's really hard to predict for me because. It feels like playing Merfolk is a little bit of a vulnerability because it's not like it's insane against Doomsday, and it's, I think, somewhat, like, fairly severely, maybe not severely, but disadvantaged against workshops. So at
It's
that point,
disadvantage against that workshops for sure.
yeah. It's, I guess, advantaged against Delver, but is Ifrit going to play another
Yes.
Delver deck? I mean, who knows?
After having lost, yeah, no, it's his what was Eric hoping to run his Delver into? Was he hoping for the mirror here when he made that choice?
I believe so, yes. So.
Well, if the best thing Eric can do against Chris's Delver is the mirror, then Delver seems like a great choice for Chris.
Yeah, I mean the mirror is, I think, a pretty difficult match to play, which I mean that might be it's the sort of thing where like if it's really close and if Chris thinks Ifrit is better, which I don't think is unreasonable, I could see not wanting to do that. Of course, the players don't know how fine-tuned each other's lists are for the mirror.
Right, exactly. I was looking. It doesn't look like either one of them have any kind of electricity tech. Eric's
Yeah.
actually got sulfur elementals against, I presume,
Yeah.
monks out of a mentor deck.
Yeah. Chris on a pretty nice draw here. Turn
Two
one
moxes.
Pyromancer. Yeah, drawing the two Moxes can be actually awesome sometimes. Because he's turn one Pyromancer with Flusterstorm up, though Ifrit doesn't have a way to counter it. And that with a Gush in hand, I mean that's a pretty solid start.
Definitely.
Chris has a Delver in hand too, right? I think that's his last card. Is that? Oh no, I guess not.
I
That
see
was an
Gush,
Ifrit.
Flusterstorm
Yeah.
land.
So Delver did flip off Spell Pierce. Spell Pierce, not again, not the most effective when your opponent knows about it.
And when your opponent had to drew two moxes.
Though Ifrit's in pretty good shape here too. I mean, Chris can't counter the Pyromancer, so it's really going to come down to whether he can gush into a Lightning Bolt. This is the turn that you really, really need that to happen.
All right. Chris is gonna float two and gush.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think. In the Delver mirror, I don't think Chris is at a heinous disadvantage. I think it's maybe slightly advantage to Ifrit. Ifrit's also played a lot more Delver recently. I know Chris likes the deck in
Yeah,
Legacy,
Chris has played a lot historically.
but Ifrit's
Came up
played
with a pyro
a ton
blast,
of
but not a
advantage
lightning
over
bolt.
like the last month. Yeah, so he gushed into Preordain. The Moxes still help here though, because now the Preordain's live to find good cards. I don't think you want Misstep or Flusterstorm here. You want cards that affect the board because you're behind on board. And even though Chris has the tokens first, he knows Ifrit's going to get to play a bunch of tokens. Well, second Pyromancer is very good here.
He went bottom bottom. Now he gets a pyromancer, and then that pyroblast on the he can pyroblast the Delver, making two
Yeah.
tokens.
Yeah, I think Chris is now actually in great shape. The second Pyromancer helps a lot. Because before, even if you killed the Delver, it was your Pyromancer with, just Flusterstorm in hand versus Ifrit's handful of cantrips, but getting double tokens is pretty significant.
Wow. Pretty good turn for Chris.
Yeah, one of the better turns you can have. I mean, one of the weaknesses of this deck is it doesn't do broken things. That turn was legitimately pretty broken. It was, you know, draw a bunch of cards and put
and
six power
Eric
on the
change.
Board.
He offers Eric the ability to trade Pyromancers, which of course Eric has no interest in.
Yeah, for sure. Well, Ifrit does get this turn. If Ifrit draws a Lightning Bolt, I mean, if he can go Preordain into Lightning Bolt, kill your Pyromancer, then it's pretty close here.
Preordains into Delver. Now he's going to Ponder.
Yeah, Ponder helps because he can trade off some tokens. I think it's reasonable to play Delver there too, though. I don't know. I may have leaned towards just playing Delver here because Delver kind of takes a turn to set up. And you're not casting anything off this Ponder this turn anyway. Oh, Ifro hadn't played a land yet, of course. No, Ifro's definitely right to lead with the Ponder and then play the Delver. The one thing about this, though, is Chris didn't draw a spell this turn, so his mana advantage isn't really helping. And your attacks aren't great here. You can't attack with Pyromancers when your opponent has tokens. So now I would expect the tokens to trade off to some degree here, though. You might want to leave one token alive if you're Ifro to keep Chris's Pyromancers back. Because right now Ifro isn't on deck to cast a spell this turn. So, yeah, I would expect though maybe just the one block, but I guess Ifro did ponder. If he knows his top card's a spell, that block makes a ton more sense. And that also flips Delver. So if Ifro's top card is like a Preordain, then this turn is pretty strong.
Ifro, how about a Brainstorm?
Yeah, that definitely works. Though it is going to give Chris the opportunity to cast Flusterstorm, so I wouldn't be surprised if Ifro just goes Pyromancer.
Yeah, the second Pyromancer, though. They're now even on Pyromancers. It's Eric's got the Delver. Chris has the two-token lead, but Eric's the one with more spells in his hand.
Yeah, and the mana advantage now, again, isn't very relevant because Chris isn't casting spells. And Ifro's catching up because Chris did Gush, and Ifro has been playing lands every turn.
Yeah, I mean, Chris is legitimately flooded. He's got 7 mana sources. That's way more than the Delver deck wants to have.
Yeah. if Chris draws a card draw spell, then, you know, all hell can break loose. Chris can Gush, play multiple spells a turn, etc.
Fetch land. 8th mana source, not what he's looking for.
Now the question is, do you attack with the Pyromancers if you're Chris? I mean, you know Ifro's Brainstorm. You just can't do that.
it just got revealed to the Delver.
Yeah, it was going to be a lot more interesting if Chris didn't see it, because then Brainstorm is like, in Lightning Bolt are the only cards that punish you. Even then, though, it's pretty risky. I guess you can actually, this is kind of interesting. Chris could strip mine pre-combat on the untapped Volcanic, prompting Ifro to Brainstorm, which gives Chris an out to cast Flusterstorm, which he kind of wants to do. But Ifro might just cast the Brainstorm here anyway. Though, you know, going to 14 is not that bad, and Brainstorming while untapped is a lot stronger. Just because you have to put 2 cards back, but if you draw a Shuffle Mechanic, then you don't have to draw one of those cards again. And Spell Pierce is about as dead as it gets. Force Will is not fantastic either.
Chris is going to use his Strip Mine.
You know, I think if you're going to Strip Mine, I think you want to do it before you attack, I guess. No, because then it just but if you do it before you attack, you force Ifro to Brainstorm if you want that to happen. This gets 2 damage through extra. So it's actually pretty close either way. It depends on whether you prefer to get 2 damage or you really want him to cast Brainstorm now. Because right now, Ifro doesn't have to cast Brainstorm.
Right.
This actually worked out best for Chris. So, you know, waiting till post-combat was ended up being superior. Because they're both getting 2 tokens off this. Again, Ifro's got the Delver. But now Ifro has Force of Will advantage because Chris is, you know, wisely using the Flusterstorm here. So if Chris draws a card draw spell, Ifro gets to snap off the Force. It is funny. I do think it is better to strip mine pre-combat, but actually this worked out better for Chris. So I think he is happier with this result. So, well, Spell Pierce, basically, effectively a blank draw here. I mean, it's a blue card, so it pitches to Force, but you already have one. The double Spell Piercers can team up, which is nice. I actually think that if Chris draws and plays like a 1-mana spell, Ifro might just double Spell Pierce it just to get value. Though I guess that runs into Mental Misstep, which Chris did draw. So Chris can attack with his tokens, and again, Ifro's in the spot where if Ifro blocks too many tokens, then Chris's Pyromancers can start offering the trade. But I guess Chris didn't because he was afraid of the crackback, because Ifro does have the Delver, which is hitting here.
Yeah, no, Chris is behind in the race. I think he just wants the game to go. He wants to have time to draw into something, anything. Yeah.
So
River keeps chipping away.
They're both going to get some tokens here. I mean, Chris is clearly going to misstep this. The question is, do you force pitching Preordain or a Spell Pierce? I actually don't think you do. I don't think you care about the Preordain that much. And you really don't want Chris to draw Gush or Dig Through Time or something, you know, that will just not end the game, but give Chris a huge advantage.
Wow, another land. 9 mana sources now.
Yeah, this is tough. Chris is poised to, you know, have everything he needs, but has just drawn so many lands. Does Chris probably has the 4 Delvers. It looks like they're both running the straight 4 Delver, 4 Pyromancer build.
Chris only has 3 Delvers.
Okay. 3 makes sense, too. I've alternated between 2 and 4 when I play the deck. I don't think you can run it off just Pyromancers, but you don't need all the Delvers, though they're quite good, you know, in games like this. I don't think Delvers are what this matchup hinges on, but clearly it can do.
Only like 16 land in the whole deck. 3 artifacts. 13 land.
Yeah, I was going to say, not 16 actual land, like something like a bunch of mana sources.
No, it's 13 land is what Chris has. He has 4 Volcanic, 4 Scalding Tarn, 3 Flooded Strand, a Strip Mine, and an Island.
So Aoife's got a tough decision here. Delver could potentially stop Aoife from winning if Chris flips it next turn. So, but using a Force of Will is a pretty big game. I like forcing here. And I like doing it while pitching Spell Pierce. Spell Pierce is so far from doing anything, and this lets you have more mana off your Lotus later, and it also plays around opposing, you know, mana denial like Spell Pierce or Flusterstorm type cards. But Chris does have opportunity to draw like a Dig Through Time now. But Misty is also pretty nice. Thing is, if you're Aoife, you know Chris doesn't have Dig or Treasure Cruise. He would have cast them earlier. Oh, yeah. There's no way you don't. So you know Delver is the only card in his hand.
Another Volcanic.
Somehow.
6, 7, 9. He drew 10 of the 16 mana sources.
Yeah, that's tough. I mean.
Yeah, I mean look, the Moxes looked great in the opening draw, right? He was able to get the Pyromancers onto the table.
Yeah, they're less great when you draw 5 lands in a row afterwards. So.
Definitely. So on to game 3. Have you seen anything about these Delver decks that would lead you to believe one of them is better set up for the mirror?
No, I mean, Aoife's got 1 Sudden Shock, 2 Pyroblast in his sideboard, which are fine. You know, Soulful Lamento does not do anything in the mirror. It's great against Mentor, but it's not a mirror card. And Aoife's main deck does have 4 Lightning Bolt, 4 Delver, which is good. It's generally better to have those than extra like Flusterstorm type effects.
Yeah, again. Chris is on 2 Lightning Bolt. Yeah, Chris is on 2 Lightning Bolts.
I mean, that's a pretty big disadvantage.
It's true. Yeah, it does sound like Eric's deck's a little better set up for the mirror. Nothing crazy good like an Electricery, but still slightly better.
It is funny that Chris got exploited in that situation because Lightning Bolt's so good against Workshops and Merfolk that Aoife has those in this deck because of those decks. And then Chris played a Delver deck, which kind of also ran into that. Not that that was like a misplay by Chris or anything. It's just funny that Aoife didn't play a card for his deck, but it ended up being good against his deck anyway. Whereas,
so much damage.
Yeah, and Aoife's not playing any Flusterstorms, which, because again, he didn't expect Chris to be playing a bunch of decks that get flustered. So that is an advantage, because Flusterstorm is really not one of the better cards in the mirror. And looks like they're both going to start on 6 cards. Chris, on the play, still probably can't keep this. Aoife on the draw definitely cannot keep this.
Yeah, single Strip Mine, single Mox Ruby. Maybe if it was a Sapphire, I think you could keep it.
Oh, yeah. If it was a Sapphire, his hand would actually be good. I mean, you'd have Probe to at least see Mental Misstep if that was a thing. And, you get to see a bunch of cards. I mean, that's just a one-land hand with a bunch of good cards in it. And the thing is, post-board games, it's not like either player is bringing in anything that's the nuts unless they, you know, there's a spare copy of Electricity floating around. But it does mean that all their cards are going to be good. Though game 1, their cards are fine too. So this matchup is just a bunch of very evenly matched cards, and it's really hard to get an insurmountable advantage. An unchecked Pyromancer is the only way, but even then, Pyromancer bolt your Pyromancer, play a cantrip, and you're kind of back to even. So,
all right. Somebody should tell them they can start. Yeah.
If Chris keeps this hand, then we will be 3 for 3 on differing mulligan decisions on close hands. but I suspect he will not. It's just, if you miss on the probe in a land light deck, the deck's land light because it has cantrips. It's not land light so you can keep one, you know, 1 mana source hands that don't produce blue. And Aoife, of course, is not remotely close to keeping. I mean, 1 Volcanic in his hand becomes good, but...
All All right, Chris Kept and Chris Mulligan into turn one Pyromancer. That seems pretty good.
Yeah, that's a strong hand. I like Ifro's hand too. I don't love it, but on six, I think I would keep because you get to play Pyromancer with Pyroblast backup, and if you draw a land and go Pyromancer Sudden Shock, that's pretty nice too. Chris's hand is much stronger though.
Yeah, you keep Eric's hand with just Black Lotus?
I think so. I don't love it, and I wouldn't fault him for mulliganing it. On the draw, though, I think it's... I mean, Lotus, Pyroblast, Pyromancer, Sudden Shock are all like pretty good cards, and the Gushes are bad here, but if you draw lands, then the Gushes become good, and five-card hands don't... I mean, a hand that can play a turn on Pyromancer with Pyroblast backup, I think is better than a five-card hand, even though you don't have other lands.
Eric seems to agree with you.
Yeah. So Eric really needs to draw a land here. I mean, clearly he kept his zero land hand, so he needs to draw a land. But if Eric can go turn one Pyromancer, land Sudden Shock your Pyromancer, then Chris goes turn two Pyromancer, then Eric plays another land and plays like a Gush, then all of a sudden we have a game.
All right, here is the turn one on Pyromancer for Chris. He's happy to see it resolve. Can Eric draw lands? Oof.
That was one of the worst cards to draw.
That one's going to take a while to be relevant.
So now the question is, do you actually play anything? Because it's a possibility that you don't even want to play the Pyromancer. Because it's so much better to go Pyromancer Sudden Shock than it is to play Pyromancer and just be two mana away from casting Sudden Shock.
I think I'm with you. I think you say go. Like, don't even put the Lotus on the table, right?
Yeah. Well, you can play the Lotus. There's not a big drawback to doing that. I don't mind playing the Lotus, but I guess Ifro's just going to keep it in hand. So if Chris drew a blank, so Ifro's got another opportunity here. If Ifro goes land Pyromancer Sudden Shock, he's still in pretty decent shape.
Now Chris is going to probably play the second young Pyro rather than hold up Pyroblast?
I think I would.
Yeah, I think I would.
Ifro didn't do anything on turn one, and yes, that could mean he's got a handful of cantrips and just needs to draw a land, but letting him resolve one cantrip while you have a Pyro in play is not a huge game. I can't see Ifro's last card.
Yeah, so. No, we can't see what he draws. It's a dig through time.
Well,
he's drawn giant Delve card followed by giant Delve card. Are we going to get a match number five?
Oh, wow. After drawing Ancestral, yes, I think we are.
Ancestral with Pyro backup?
Though I kind of like just passing here.
Interesting.
You don't really need to do anything. All right, Ruby is a little late to the party, but not heinous. I mean, Ifro does get to cast Pyromancer and Sudden Shock this turn, which Chris may or may not be able to deal with.
Well, Sudden Shock is, he won't even get the tokens off his Ancestral.
Well, I think if Ifro goes Ruby, Chris probably lets it resolve, and then Ifro cracks Lotus for red and casts Pyromancer. I guess he could just cast the Pyromancer first.
That is what he's doing. He's leading with the Pyromancer.
Chris is likely to Ancestral in response here.
I think I agree with that.
Which means Chris will get some tokens. And you can Pyroblast this.
Red for Pyro, that's what I was looking at. By not responding to the Lotus, Chris has sort of opened up Pyroblast.
He has. Yeah.
And Eric's going to take him up on the offer.
I think you have the Pyro here, even though you can't cast Sudden Shock later. Chris at least can't counter back. He's got a bunch of Pyroblasts.
All true.
But Chris gets to attack Ifro for six, and if Chris just draws lands, and then Ifro draws a land and goes land mocks, Sudden Shock, it's still pretty hard for Ifro to win this game. Cause it's, blue card for Force of Will makes it very difficult for Ifro. Interesting, not attacking with the Pyromancers.
Doesn't want to offer the trade, apparently.
I think be jamming those Pyromancers in there. I mean, it's not going to be relevant here, but I would much 1-0 is I think a lot stronger than 2-1 because it's not like Chris is that close to casting spells either. Ifro is in a situation where he has more castable spells potentially, though. I suppose Ifro's so constrained on mana that maybe Chris is happier with this.
There's the Volcanic Island finally.
Question is, do you Force of Will the Mox Ruby? I don't. think you do, but Sudden Shock is interesting. Oh, Chris
is thinking about it.
He's going to go for it. All right.
So will your Mox Ruby?
That's going to work out, I think, pretty well for Chris.
The guy hasn't played any land. It's like turn five. I think you do force a little.
I guess just getting the tokens right away. Yeah, this is probably right. Getting the tokens right away is pretty good.
And yeah, that Sudden Shock is still turned off. Still not to Treasure Cruise.
Now Chris has to just smash with everything.
Right? Yeah, I might have even Pyroblasted a land.
Yeah. Well, after drawing the Flusterstorm, I think it even makes it easier.
Sure.
But
just the four tokens. Delver. It's a castable spell.
Yeah, we're going to do it. Looks like we're going to go to a game five here.
Wow. Match number five. Chris Pakula, 2-1. He wins the Delver Mirror. So he lost the first two. He's won the last two. It comes down to match number five. More magic.
We're getting to see pretty close to the max amount here, which is nice.
Now, what do they do with their deck choices? All right, so your first be Eric.
Yeah,
thinking if you're Eric Froelich here.
I still think if I'm Eric, I'm likely to play Workshops. I think Workshops is pretty decent against Delver, and it's quite good against the Merfolk deck. And it's at the very least slightly ahead against other Workshop deck, I have to imagine, with like Batterskull, Wurmcoil. I mean, Sword is not irrelevant, but even if Chris knows, I mean, Chris is just running back Delver, I guess, is your best bet. The problem with Ifrit playing Delver again is if Chris runs back Merfolk, then that could be tough. Because Merfolk against Delver, you'd rather not be on the Delver side of that.
I feel like if I'm Eric, Workshops is just the best deck.
Yeah, and I don't think he can run Doomsday. Doomsday, I think you don't want to play against Workshops, and you don't love it against Delver. It's fine against Delver, but you don't love it as much as... I think Workshops has good to decent matchups, whereas Doomsday has like decent to bad matchups. So I like running the Workshops deck here. I don't think Chris really has a way to exploit that either.
All right, now you're Chris Pakula. What do you
probably
think?
Delver has the best shot against the Workshop deck, and that's Ifro's strongest deck, I think.
So yeah, and Ifro's best counter to Delver is a mirror match that you just won.
Yes.
Yeah, I think now, and if Chris is staying on Delver, maybe Eric just runs back the Delver deck because he is.
Yeah.
I mean, they don't have the deck lists, but from our look at it, it looks like Eric's list is slightly better for the mirror.
Yeah. Eric having four Lightning Bolts and zero Flusterstorms, I think, is and the fourth Delver, I think, does mean that, you know, we could just see the mirror again. If Chris really wants to level up, he could try to, you know, run the Merfolk deck here. But if Ifrit just picks the Workshop deck, then that does not seem like it ends well.
Yeah, I still feel like there's a decent chance Eric picks Workshops.
Yeah.
Wow, now I want to see what happens.
Yeah, the last match, it looks like the game is up here. So
Chris has chosen. What will Eric take into battle with him? Best 3 out of 5 matches. They both brought 3 different decks. They can choose freely any of their 3 decks for this one last match. Eric?
And it's the Delver Mirror again.
Yeah, it looks like the mirror.
And it looks like Eric's on the play here.
Interesting. Now, how are these draws? Chris has a turn one Delver, I guess?
Yeah, Eric's going to have a turn one Time Walk followed by a Preordain. Chris doesn't have a Misstep or anything, so it's going to end up... Eric's going to get to do that. Eric has Force and Misdirection, but he's going to kind of run out of blue cards. He's going to start playing some cards. So Chris is going to lead with like Probe. He's going to see these cards. He's probably just going to play Delver still. And Eric's potentially going to force it. I mean, Eric's going to see... Chris has more card draw to begin with, but Eric's going to see a lot more cards. And Eric's going to have a 3-0 mana advantage to start the game off. So that's pretty good. It just basically, if he throws Preordain, has to hit like, you know, Gush Pyromancer type stuff in the next couple turns here.
Nope. There's Gush.
There's Gush. So if he Preordains into Pyromancer, I think Ifro's significantly far ahead.
There's the Preordain.
Ideally would have been drawing Pyromancer, playing a land, playing a Preordain, playing a Gush. But this works out pretty well too.
I think if he finds finds Pyromancer here, he's plenty happy. He found Strip Mine.
Yeah, which I imagine is like putting both the bottom type situation. Though Strip Mine,
he doesn't know what he's fighting yet.
He doesn't, but
now he does.
Yeah, Strip Mine actually quite good here.
I mean, it is against Chris's draw, that's for sure.
Oh, Chris not interested in probing. He's keeping probe for to pitch to Force of Will, I imagine. I guess he just doesn't care what Ifro has. You know, Ifro's Strip Mine could be awesome here. I think you still lead with Gush because you might want to replay one of your other lands instead, but...
Yeah, you might.
But Strip Mining turn one is pretty nice when your opponent doesn't play a Mox or anything.
You want to Strip Mine before your opponent has a Gush as well. I mean, you know your opponent's got Gush in his deck, so...
So it looks like you're just going to wait on the Gushes.
Huh.
Well, Chris either flips Delver or plays land. The worst case scenario is like flipping Young Pyromancer or something. So he did peel the land, though he had two bites of the apple with the Gitaxian Probe. Chris's optimal was flipping Delver, then probing into land.
Delver chips away for one.
I still like probing if I'm Chris before I'm casting something like Preordain. I would like to know what I'm up against before making decisions. Also, you might want to leave Pyroblast up at that point. Chris seeing a DAC, which is assuredly going to the bottom.
Yep.
Treasure Cruise, which also probably going to the bottom too. You don't really need it when you have Dig and only one land.
Came up with a Young Pyromancer, but does not have the second mana. Now it's Gush time for Eric.
Yeah, and Mental Misstep is not bad here.
Comes up with a Dig and a Delver, it looks like.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess you could just play Delver. You're not quite to the point where you can cast Dig. Next turn, you can potentially cast Dig if more your cards go to the graveyard. So then, if Delver goes in the stack, I don't think Chris counters it. I think you just Pyroblast it, which gets misstepped, which potentially... You know, if Chris Pyroblasts Ifro's Delver and Ifro misdirects it to Chris's Delver, that's a huge game.
Is that a thing that could happen here?
I guess actually Ifro could cast Dig here. Sorry, Ifro has exactly enough to cast Dig, so it's possible that Ifro just taps out completely to cast Dig through time.
Delving four and spending four?
Yeah, spending four on a Dig is kind of unfortunate in the mirror, but resolving a Dig into someone who can't have Pyroblast up or Fluster Stomp is pretty nice. Actually, it probably would just Dig here.
Looks like that's what Eric's going to do.
You'd have loved to have a fetch land and just Dig. I mean, I assume it's going to get forced and then probably forced back.
The
question is,
pitches the Gush, not the Probe. Like, a Taxing Probe's just been sitting in his hand the whole game.
Yeah.
It's not the Force of Will card either, apparently.
And Ifro's going to choose to use the Misdirection here, pitching the Delver, actually. That way he keeps Force of Will up for a potential Young Pyromancer, I assume, is the card that is the most dangerous.
That makes sense. I mean, if he was Psychic, he might keep the Misdirection for a potential Pyroblast, but... He's pitching his Delver anyway, so that scenario is not even come up.
And I like keeping Misstep. I think that card's going to be pretty good against someone stuck on one land. Like, they're just so... And the deck's full of one-mana spells, so... Mm-hmm.
So by misdirecting back, effectively Force of Will increases Force of Will, Eric is going to get to resolve Dig Through Time.
And again, Chris in the spot where drawing a land would be fantastic, and drawing a spell would let you flip Delver.
Again, he wants to go spell and then probe it into land, maybe.
Ifro found Bolt Ancestral, which is pretty close to ideal here.
Those are good cards.
Yeah, Ifro's ahead on mana and ahead on cards, but Chris is slightly ahead on board with the Delver. And if Delver flips and then you end up playing a Pyromancer, like if you probe into a land.
Delver does flip. Can he probe into a land?
So you feel letting Probe resolve, even though he's got Misstep, which I think is right. And the Probe is just cycling. You could definitely do better with your Missteps.
Totally agree.
So if you see this hand and then you draw the land, do you even play the Pyromancer? You just know it's going to get forced. You might want to just go Preordain, leave up Pyroblast. So Chris knows he can't cast Ancestral here. He can cast Preordain. Thing is, leaving, like, no matter what, Mental Misstep's gonna take one of your turns worth of spells. I like Cast Empyrean here. I think Chris is doing absolutely the right play. Just because if you leave up Pyroblast and then Ifrit just passes the turn back, you wasted a whole mana, and you only get one a turn right now. You don't have a lot of mana to waste.
Yeah, Preordain seems great. Now, do you misstep it if you're Eric?
Yeah, I like misstepping it. Chris would misstep back potentially, though. He sees your Ancestral, so maybe not. But you're going to get to see a bunch of cards, and Chris has been missing land drops, revealing the Preordain. You know he's missing his land drop if this doesn't resolve. So Ifrit not even playing the land first. I guess if Chris did something, Ifrit would gush. Not gush, he would just pitch it to force. So Ifrit, pretty weak Ancestral, actually.
Two lands and a Preordain off the Ancestral Recall. Eric cracks a fetch land, now Preordains.
Yeah, looking for Delve cards and Pyromancers, basically. The deck actually is getting kind of okay here. Ifrit doesn't know about the Pyroblast, but Ifrit has a lot of mana in his hand and in place. Dak is good when you're rich on resources. When you have cards to discard and it's not hard to cast it, Dak actually is pretty strong. Gush is actually not the strongest. I kind of like just bolt past the turn here.
Looks like that's Eric's decision. Now he's just ahead on most axes.
Yeah, Chris is going to go for the Ancestral.
He has to hope.
I think for sure you snap off the Force Will here.
I mean, you could do one of the Gushes as a response, see if you have a worse blue card, I guess.
Yeah, but the thing is, you're not going to get to cast two Gushes next turn anyway. You're only still going to get to cast the one. So I like forcing here, untapping, and gushing with all your mana available.
I'll buy that.
Chris is just not playing lands here. If you let Ancestral resolve, Chris gets to play spells. And Ifro's actually seen a lot more cards, but... Ifrit's drawn a lot of extra cards, and most of them are land.
Yep. It's funny, the game that Chris lost in the first time they played this mirror, he lost because he drew too many land. Clearly, he needed to put a more in-between amount of lands in his deck.
So Ifrit choosing not to gush here, which means he does get potentially pyroblasted. And the way things worked out, Ifrit's now going to cast Preordain, and true. And Chris is going to get to mental misstep it, which I think you do. And then if Ifrit gushes, Chris can Pyroblast. Actually, Chris...
He's paying?
Oh, wow.
He paid blue mana.
I would gush in response here to try to hit your own mental misstep this point. Paying is surprising. Chris is at... His life total is under no duress here.
Came up with a Delver.
Yeah, Ifrit's not in great shape. Ifrit has millions of lands in play, though. I think he needed to play Misty Rainforest there. Just because if he sees a bad card with Delver, he could shuffle it away. Chris Strong Strip Mine was actually kind of good for Ifrit because Strip Mine doesn't cast Dig Through Time. Ifrit doesn't care about Strip Mine, and Ifrit's much happier with Chris casting Pyromancer than Chris Pyroblasting his Delver. Because it lets you use Lightning Bolt.
That's it. Chris finally got the 2 mana. That 2 mana does turn Chris's hand on.
Yes, certainly.
Most of it.
No, Ifrit sees another Lightning Bolt here, so Chris can't tap out for Pyromancer. But Strip Mine is just like the worst land to draw. It just doesn't.
Agreed.
It doesn't help cast Dig, is the problem.
Agreed.
So you've got a Pyroblast here. You can't play a Pyromancer into a Lightning Bolt. So now it's Lightning Bolt and a lot of mana. So if Ifrit draws almost any good spell, he's really far ahead. But Chris is the one with actual spells. Well,
how about Young Pyromancer? Does that count as a good spell?
It is. Because now if Chris Force of Wills this, which is a very reasonable play, you can't even cast the Dig. Now it's Pyromancer versus Lightning Bolt. Chris getting the first draw step, but Ifrit ahead on lands by so much. I think Ifrit now is ahead in the game.
It's pretty close.
Yeah.
They're basically in top deck mode.
They're in top deck mode. Chris can't even cast the Pyromancer, but basically Ifrit can cast... Well, I guess, at this point, Chris drew the land, so now Chris can cast anything, too. Whoever draws the first draw spell here is in a huge edge, and yeah, Dak Faden, I think, will almost assuredly put the game away unless Ifrit misses. Basically, Ifrit has to miss on Dak, and Chris has to hit on his turn immediately. Otherwise, Ifrit sees so many cards.
Yeah, I mean, they're in top deck mode, and now Eric's top decking 3 cards, right?
Yeah, it looks like the game froze, though. I mean, Ifrit's casted Dak, Dacked into Pyromancer, but yes. At this point, the game that we're watching is not getting updated.
Right. The hands are getting updated, but not the gameplay.
So Ifrit dacked, discarded, and then played a Pyromancer, leaving Lightning Bolt up, is what we can imagine. Yeah, we
Yeah.
can. Okay, so right now, Ifro's got Dak in play and a Pyromancer. Chris
Yeah,
drew
we should probably.
Pyroblast.
Yeah,
It
we
looks
should
like
pause that.
we're gonna pause them real quick.
Hopefully they see the pause.
So this is a pretty close scenario here. I think Ifro's ahead, but Chris did draw the Pyroblast. So like we're just seeing like haymaker after haymaker, and Chris being able to get rid of Dak Faden means that Ifro's ahead because he's got a Pyromancer and a Bolt versus Chris's Pyromancer. So Ifro's got a good advantage, but if Dak untapped and got to activate again, I think the game was just basically over. So we'll see where we are when we come back momentarily here.
Yeah, big picture, we are in game one of match number five.
Correct.
So game one of match number five, these guys are playing one last best two out of three match to see who wins the Vintage Super League. Number one seed Chris Pakula or number one ranked in the world, Eric Froelich. It's a Delver mirror match. That is what they've chosen from their set of decks.
Yeah, and I think that that is the safest. Chris, I think, is the safest for Chris to play Delver. Chris can try to eke out an edge by playing Merfolk, but I think that the punishment for playing Merfolk against Workshops is much, much greater than the edge you get of playing Merfolk against Delver. Because it's not like Merfolk can never lose to a deck that has four Delver of Secrets and four Lightning Bolts and four Young Pyromancers. I mean, those cards are also good against the Merfolk deck. So I think that, and I think Ifro's reasoning is that he likes. I'm judging from this that he likes the Delver versus Delver matchup a lot more than the Workshops versus Delver matchup. He feels like if he played Workshops and Chris played Delver, then Ifro would be in not great shape. Whereas Delver versus Delver, he thinks that at least very close, regardless of who you think is advantaged. So I think that ends up making the most sense. That, like, I don't know what the actual like game theory equilibrium is, but I think it's on Chris playing Delver, and I think it's on Ifro deciding which one he wants to play against Delver. I don't think Doomsday is a great choice, and I don't think Chris really wants to play Workshops all that much. Though Chris could play Workshops against Ifro's Delver deck. That's interesting too. But Ifro actually has stuff like Pulverize in his deck, which Chris doesn't know. And I guess Delver did beat Ifro or Chris's Workshop deck when they played.
True. All right. Well, we are back in the match. Eric has Young Pyromancer in play. Chris is trying to resolve a Delver, but Eric had the mental misstep for it.
And Chris still knows about that lightning bolt, which is why he's not playing anything. So
Indeed.
Eric's reasonably far ahead here. Chris has to draw like a treasure cruise into something good, or I guess draw a lightning bolt. If Chris draws his own lightning bolt, of which he does not have a ton of,
Right.
then he can kill Ifro's Pyromancer. So it looks like Chris,
Yeah, he has to go for the Gunpyro at this
well, he
point.
knows about the lightning bolt though. So I mean, I don't think Chris is in great shape, but
It's a healing salve. He's going for a
yeah.
healing salve.
I get no, yeah, Chris is dead if he doesn't do that. He has to cast that. You're right. So Chris now goes to two, and if Ifro drew anything, the game would be over basically. And even if he doesn't, there's very few cards that Chris can draw that'll get him out of being at twos facing down a 2-2-1 and 2-1-1s.
Yeah, Force of Will's not going to get it done. So Eric Froelich wins game number one. And you know what? That felt like, I mean, it was a match where Chris was pinned on one land for most of the game. But on the other side, Eric was flooded. So I don't know that that. I mean, Eric didn't have the best draw for punishing Chris for being mana screwed.
Yeah.
What
What
Eric
Eric,
did have was a never-ending string of lightning bolts. He drew
what?
three lightning bolts that game.
Yeah, and that's one of the edges in this particular matchup is Eric has, obviously you can compare card to card wherever you want, but if one way to look at it is, he's got Lightning Bolt or Chris has Flusterstorms, like that's a huge, huge edge. So,
I agree. Yeah, and I mean, Chris isn't capable of drawing three lightning bolts. He's only got two on his list.
right.
And they were great there. They were answers to the best card in the matchup, Young Pyromancer.
The interesting thing about these decks and this matchup is that you can go from being mana screwed on one mana to having the 2 mana or 3 mana and having the perfect amount. So Chris had a couple draw steps where he could break out and play a bunch of stuff if he drew a land. Ifro had some draw steps where if he drew a dig or a cruise, the game would be over. It turned out that neither player drew the exact right. Ifro drew enough cards out to stay slightly ahead of Chris, and Chris drew lands a little too late. So it was actually a really close game, even though Chris was behind for basically the whole game.
I mean, Eric drew Dak.
Yeah.
It didn't stick around for long, but it stuck around long enough, right?
Dak was plus two cards essentially, because the two islands in Ifrit's hand didn't do a whole lot. He ended up discarding like a card he drew anyway, but it also was minus one card because it killed Chris's Pyroblast, and that was enough. I mean, we're talking about a game where a Preordain drawn by either side would have been huge.
That's
And
one
Dax.
where their lists are symmetrical on Dax, by the way. They both have exactly two.
Yeah, which makes sense.
All right. How about we watch game two?
Sounds like a plan.
Delver, Delver, Ancestral, and a Force for Chris off one land. That seems pretty good.
Yeah, this is the hand that doesn't want to run into misstep, but Ifrit has no missteps. Ifrit's hand is fine too. It's just he doesn't have a misstep, so Chris is going to resolve turn one Ancestral, presumably find enough lands to play some Delvers. Ifrit's going to play like maybe a turn one Delver and then hope to preordain into more lands. I think Chris being on the play and resolving Ancestral, unsurprisingly gives him a bit of an edge. He also has like Force of Will, which does help. Oh, so he's just going to
Wow.
run out the Delver turn one.
Turn one Delver, not
Yeah,
turn two.
that actually makes more sense. I of course am always like, in the
Draw a
mode of casting
card.
Ancestral, but turn one Delver does make sense because Delver again takes a turn to warm up, and then it does give Ifrit more chances to draw disruptive cards, but you'd rather have the Delver in play and force Ifrit to deal with that.
Yeah, it's not like Eric can just leave his mana untapped to counter a potential turn two Ancestral.
So it's interesting. Ifrit chose not to play his own Delver. He chose to cast Preordain in response, presumably banking on trying to set up a Pyromancer here. Is that the idea? Oh, finding a Sapphire was actually really good.
Nice.
So now I actually kind of like the Delver. I mean, it depends on what Ifrit knows, if Ifrit knows what his top card is. I guess if you really want to play a turn two Pyromancer, you can't have Pyroblast back up quite yet. Force is okay. It's not great. Force does give you let you use the Delver though, if you don't think that the Delver is going to matter as much as like the Dig Through Time, which makes sense. So Chris, happy flipping Delver, happy drawing land, not as happy drawing
Ooh.
another Delver.
No, that was not the right answer. But he's going to play it. He's still not going to Ancestral.
Wow.
Wow.
I think I would have Ancestral there because you have
I would
Force
have
back up.
to. You want to find a land.
The reward for playing a land is so good.
Agreed. All right. Eric has only the one red mana, so he cannot defend this young Pyromancer from any potential Force of Wills.
Yeah, not with
Oh,
Pyroblasts.
Pyroblast, anyway.
He can force back. I think if I were Chris, I would probably pitch. I could see pitching Gush here.
Me
The
too.
Delver you can still cast, which is nice, and a bunch of Delvers can beat a Pyromancer pretty easily. Question is, if you're Ifrit, do you force back, or do you just play like a Delver, or do you force pitching the Delver? You're not. I guess you're pretty close to casting Dig Through Time. You could also just let it happen and play your second Pyromancer, but I don't know, this is pretty close.
You're gonna get outraced by those two Delvers if you play it that way, right?
Yeah. You do have a Pyroblast to kill one of them and put a token into play, but here's where having the basic island instead of a volcanic island was kind of unfortunate.
True.
But you clearly have to play a basic island in your deck. You can't just
Yes.
concede to Wastelands that badly.
Yeah, you have to have one, which is what they have.
Wow, this is really close.
Yeah, he decides not to force back, but to play a Delver.
So now they're even on Delvers. Chris is presumably going to go for Ancestral. This is a turn where flipping Delver would be immense.
Survey says.
Flip.
Yes, he does get to flip it.
All
Which
right.
means they both flip, of course. There's a Pyroblast.
Let's see. Is Chris just going to continue running out Delvers? He's done that the last couple turns.
It's true. He's has not been going for Ancestral. I think you and I would have both been tempted to draw three cards, hope one of them's a land, and then you still get to play your Delver. Now that is Chris's line.
The funny thing is, I actually kind of like Delver more this turn than I did last turn.
Really?
Yeah,
Why is
but
that?
now that you've got all your Delvers, I think just playing more Delvers is better. You don't care about resolving Ancestral as much because you have two flip Delvers already. So
Okay.
I think next turn Ancestral and fighting over it's pretty nice. All right, flipping Delver off Probe is not bad because Ifrit can now. Depends how greedy he wants to get. He can play Pyromancer and then hard cast Probe to hope to draw a red source. He's going to see the Pyroblast in Chris's hand. So actually, paying the 2 life doesn't change the clock. So that's probably better because you can draw Preordain also.
Yeah, 10 versus 12 doesn't matter. Sees what he's dealing with, draws a Delver.
Wow, this game's going to be really close because now Chris gets to Pyroblast Ifrost Delver. If Chris,
yes,
I mean that he needs to draw a land. He wants to be able to play Delver and a land in the same turn and a Pyroblast in the same turn.
He probes. He sees the Pyroblast.
Yeah. Oh wow, Mental Misstep was huge.
That might be good enough, right?
Yeah, it's going to be because now Ifro's going to four. So Ifro needs to flip his Delver off a Mental Misstep. That's Ifro's, I think, optimal scenario. Or like flip it off Gush or something like that. And what does Ifro do?
He doesn't flip it. So he just dies, right?
Now he's dead. He needed to flip it both because he needed a spell and because Chris drew the Mental Misstep.
Yeah, Mental Misstep counters the Pyroblast. Now those two Delvers are lethal. How about we play one game for the Vintage Super League Championship?
Sounds like a plan.
One game. Delver versus Delver. Eric Froelich will be on the play, having lost that game.
Yeah, being on the play is pretty big. I mean, the decks are so evenly matched, and these decks are very good at cycling through all their cards. They're not as good at like coming back when they're up against a bad board position. They just don't have sweepers, and if your opponent, like if one of them leads on like Lotus Pyromancer 2 cantrips, it's so hard to come back from that. Even if you kill the Pyromancer, they still got a couple tokens out of the deal.
Sounds right. So one game, Eric on the play. The winner, we haven't really talked about this, by the way. The winner gets a foil set of Vintage Masters. So there's decent stakes.
So Ifro's going to keep a very solid, if not super exciting hand. Chris is going to have to mulligan. The strip mine only hand is not going to do it. And Ifro gets to, I mean, this is great, right, for Ifro in that, like, on the play going turn one Delver, turn two Delver into Preordain. Very strong. Like, that's just, you just end up ahead on board and you get to see a lot of cards. Like, this is the kind of close to the ideal hand. You'd love a Mental Misstep in this hand instead of one of the lands. Like, the third land isn't great. This hand, I think, is very keepable from Chris, but it's not the kind of hand that wins the game. It's the kind of hand that ends up hoping to draw into some action. Just because you have Pyroblast to kill Ifro's turn one play, you have Force Pitch and Gush, but then you end up with like nothing. Whereas Ifro's hands are all like the cards that replace themselves and one mana cards that you can cast, whereas Force of Will is not really where you want to be. It's funny how Force is like one of the most important cards and one of the weakest cards, because forcing their big plays is important, but there's not that many big plays. And, you know, when you force their Delver or Pyromancer, like that's not great for you. So Chris, this is that kind of hand where if Chris drew a Pyromancer, he'd be really in business. But instead, I imagine he's going to want to Pyroblast the Delver. Actually, I don't mind just passing. Pyroblasting main phase. Thing is, Ifro's not playing Flusterstorms, though. I guess Chris doesn't really know
that.
Yeah,
Chris doesn't know
that. Drawing the land was pretty bad for Ifro. I mean, you obviously, like, any land net from here on out is basically just a dead card. But Chris isn't... The thing is, Gushing is so good when you have a threat in play, and so much less good when you're just, like, floating mana Gushing and hoping to draw something.
All true. All right. Eric with the Preordain.
Yeah,
he knows he's gonna follow. He knows he's likely to follow this up with a Delver. So,
yeah, Ifro's best.
Fun.
You know, his best case scenario is finding two good spells to leave one on top and draw one. You wouldn't want to leave a land and a spell on top and then draw the land, because flipping Delver isn't that important. But yeah, if it's close, he'd rather flip it. Chris clearly not gonna force wall either of those cards. Chris not really super happy about Flusterstorm either. It's interesting here. So Chris can cast Gush. You know it's going to resolve because you have Flusterstorm up and Ifro can't cast Pyroblast. Problem is, if you Gush and miss on Pyromancer or Delver, it's pretty bad for you. But I think I would cast Gush here. I don't think that waiting the extra turn is really going to help that much. And you have three mana, so even if you Gush and miss, next turn you could still cast a top deck Pyromancer.
That is what Chris agrees. Preordain is all he comes up with. Cast it. Time Walk, which he's not floating the right mana for.
Though I think he floated the correct mana. He's got the ruby, which I guess he doesn't need.
Right, yeah, it's the existence of the ruby is the only reason I think he might float blue-blue there.
Yeah, so Chris looks like he kept Time Walk, and I don't know if he kept the other card or not, or what it was, but
Drew
he can't cast
walk.
It now.
No. Yeah, already played a land.
So he's going to pass. Ifro's presumably going to flip Delver, because even if Ifro didn't find a spell, he might brainstorm in response to the trigger. Chris still probably not in a position where he really wants to force a will brainstorm. Ruby being Ruby, not Sapphire, is kind of punishing Chris here too, unfortunately. True. Just because this is the turn where Chris does not have Flusterstorm up. So now here we get to find out. Looks like Ifo did not keep two spells. He either kept the other card or put it on the bottom, and it looks like he put it on the bottom.
So this is Eric responding to the Delver of Secrets trigger putting a spell on top of his library.
Yeah, which is going to be Preordain. He's going to put Island Preordain. He's going to reveal Preordain. He's going to play Pyromancer. Chris is going to force a will to Pyromancer. And it's going to be Eric's Delver, Gush, and Preordain and Misstep versus Chris's probably like Gush Time Walk. I think you pitch Flusterstorm at this point. You certainly can't let Pyromancer resolve unless you know your top card is like a Lightning Bolt. And even then, there's not that much better to force a will. Again, this matchup is not about, you know, resolving a Tinker or a Doomsday.
All right. So Eric ships over for three with the Insectile Aberration. Now he goes for Young Pyromancer. We expect Chris to force a will this.
I do not expect Ifo to gush back.
Flusterstorm is the card Chris pitches, and there you go. Young Pyromancer on its way to the yard.
This board position is super even. I mean, Ifro's ahead because, look, they have all the same cards, and Ifro has a Preordain and a Delver. But, well, not Chris has a Pyromancer, so we're coming up to a very evenly matched set of circumstances here. And it looks like Chris is going to pass without gushing, I think. He could gush. It plays around a Pyroblast. I don't think you gush in response if you're Ifro. Just losing the mana, I think, is too devastating.
Yeah, Young Pyromancer resolves.
This is really tricky. What mana do you tap for if you want to gush right now? I actually like gushing right now to play around Pyroblast. You have so many more blue spells, but if you hit a Lightning Bolt or a Pyroblast, you really want to kill the Delver now. Probably still safer to tap for blue. I don't know. I mean, it's a higher reward if you hit on red, but it's so much safer to tap for blue.
He floated a red and then changed his mind.
One reason to pass, which I think makes sense from Chris, is that you have Mental Misstep, which plays around opposing Pyroblast, so you're not in as much of a hurry. Again, gushing in a turn where you're not going to get to use the mana is really brutal.
All right. Well, here's Preordain from Eric, which Chris is going to point his Mental Misstep at.
So he's paying the two life here. I guess because he wants to be able to gush into Pyroblast. Ifro, I imagine, will misstep back.
I imagine he does.
Question now is, does Chris gush? I still don't love gushing here. I understand it, but like if Chris really wants to hit it, but you know, fighting over Preordain is not the end of the world. I'd rather have the mana on my turn.
I think I gush here. I mean, you're going to be able to cast whatever you want on your turn anyway.
That's true. It just feels like there's going to be more spells to fight over than this. So Ifro, since Ifro's going to gush anyway, he might as well gush now. Because if he finds a Pyroblast or something, he'd much rather use it.
Game hanging in the balance. Both players gush. None of that is going to stop Chris's gush. Let's see what he comes up with. Comes up with another gush and a Mock Sapphire. That is not great for Chris Bakula.
No. I think Ifro's got a sizable advantage here. I mean, clearly Ifro is going to get to see so many more cards. And his Delver is slightly ahead here, given that he gets to attack first. And Chris, you know, Chris's turn is down
12. But the fact that he paid the two life for that Mental Misstep dropped him down from 14 to 12. Now it's 4 Delver hits.
Chris's next turn is, unless he draws something, Landmocks go.
Agreed. Yeah, Chris is nothing. Actual nothing. Eric resolved another Preordain.
And he's found treasure cruise,
which he can just cast for 1 mana. First, he's going to take a look, and he's going to be pretty happy when this Gitaxian Probe resolves. Eric Froelich is going to see a hand that he believes he can beat. And wow. His top decks the last 2 turns have been Treasure Cruise followed by Ancestral Recall.
Yeah, I mean, Ifro's going to get to see a ton of cards. He hasn't played a land yet, so if he finds a Lightning Bolt here, then the game is very close to being over. Even if he doesn't, he's going to see so many more cards, and he's got enough life that it's going to be hard for Chris to come back here.
Yeah, he Treasure Cruised into Dig and Force of Will.
I would Ancestral here. You might end up discarding, but, I mean, using the extra mana is so important, and who cares if you discard Island?
He comes up with a Mox.
And a Pyromancer, so I think we might know who our champion is. This is going to be really hard for Chris to come back from. The game is not over, but Ifro has a force for Chris's next play. He's got a Delver. Next turn, Ifro is going to be able to draw like 20 more cards off Gush, Dig, and Preordain. So Chris might be locked out from playing another spell this game.
You're not going to count Mock Sapphire as a spell, right?
No, and it does not trigger Pyromancer, so.
Chris is going to chip away with those tokens. But yeah, he doesn't realize quite how far behind he is. He can't see Eric's hand.
Well,
but we know.
Ifrit just drew 6 cards. You can't feel like you're in a good spot here.
Fair, fair. Yeah. Didn't really need to see Eric's hand to know that was a bad turn for him.
There just aren't that many combinations of cards that Eric draws that are good for Chris. Like, all lands is about as good as it gets.
All right. Preordain from Eric, triggering Young Pyromancer. Going to get more cards.
I mean, it's possible that Ifrit finds like Time Walk or Lightning Bolt to end the game really quickly. But even, yeah, like a second Pyromancer. Again, there's no. It's not like Chris can top deck Yawgmoth's Will and play 10 spells and play a Tendrils.
Right. That's Ifrit gets not to, how these decks work.
Yeah, Ifrit gets to play Pyromancer. He's got Gush to make 2 tokens and Force to make tokens. Like, Ifrit has to do very little to win this game from this point on.
Right. Eric Froelich rattled off 6 wins in a row to clinch the playoffs as the first guy, the last undefeated in the regular season. Limped into the playoffs, losing 3 matches and a tiebreaker match with Dredge, but wow. Number 1 ranked now, Eric Froelich. Crushed me in the quarters, crushed you in the semis. Has gotten himself a fight here in the finals with Chris Pakula, but it's match 5, game 3, but everything is coming up, Froelich. The lightning, yeah. The sudden shock, the second Young Pyromancer. Down goes Chris's Young Pyro. Overcome the Delver and the first Young Pyromancer. Chris is going to get to look at one more draw step, but Eric's got a Force of Will for whatever it is.
Yeah, I mean, Chris certainly didn't get smashed. He went to match 5, game 5.
And match 5, yeah, last possible
game 3.
Game.
And these games have been so close. Like,
oh, yeah.
You know, game 1 was hinged off like every draw step. This game, there was a lot of draw steps where either player could just pull ahead. And, you know, but... You know, these decks also do tend to snowball. Once you get ahead, you end up like, you know, the first person to resolve a Delve spell is going to frequently be the only person drawing cards for the rest of the game.
Yeah, now Chris is just trying to think what he could possibly come up with. Gushes.
And Ifrit could force this Gush because he knows that Chris has got a bunch of lands in hand, but there's no real reason to do that. Unless you think that Chris has like some sort of split second or uncounterable spell left in his deck. Yeah, Volcanic Fallout would in fact, well, put Chris to 2 so he could get Sudden Shocked, but... So, yeah, Chris is going to get to go down, or I guess pay a blue mana to cast Attacks and Probe. Draw just another land.
First trouble. Wow. Eric Froelich, ladies and gentlemen. Made the playoffs last year in Vintage Super League. This year, made the playoffs and got it done.
Bolting Ifrit down to 10 here. Last bit of defiance.
There you go. Eric wins. 3-2. Maximum possible magic. All 5 matches. But in the end, Eric Froelich basically split the 2 Delver mirrors.
Yeah.
Split the 2 Delver mirrors. And he wins. Great. I think I want to talk to Eric now. I'm going to
sounds like
out.
A plan.
We will be right back momentarily with the winner interview. Don't go anywhere.